this morning to 2 Timothy chapter 3. We're going to continue our study on the doctrine of the inspiration of Scripture. We started that last week, and I will do that again in this first period this morning. And when you pick up a doctrine, you can preach a doctrine for weeks and months and a long, long time. But this morning will be the second on the inspiration of the Scriptures. And then next week we'll pick up with preservation of Scriptures and continue on from there. So I'm kind of limiting the thing so that we don't go on and on and on and on one particular doctrine. I think we'll have laid sufficient foundation with last week and with what we're going to do this morning. And I hope that you'll find the material that we've gathered here this morning on this subject to be of help and an interest and an encouragement. The end of the whole thing is that we have confidence that we hold in our hand the very words of God, inspired, inerrant, and perfectly preserved without error. So that we have confidence as we open this book, as we read this book, as we study this book, as we share the words of this book with others, we have the confidence that we're sharing the very words of God, the inspired words of God, God-breathed words. And that's important. So we're going to hit the two places that we were last week to begin this, and then we're going to take you to another place, and then I'm going to use the time to kind of rattle off some information and things through here that will hopefully be of help to us. All right, so we're in 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning at verse 14. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned, and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise in salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, throughly furnished unto all good works. Then go with me back to 2 Peter chapter 1. Turn to your right, and you'll find 2 Peter there. Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 2 Peter. And we're at 2 Peter chapter 1. And we're reading verses 19, 20, and 21. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 19, 20, and 21. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So last week, as we began studying the doctrine of inspiration, between these two passages which we've read again here this morning, we talked about that it's the Holy Scriptures that are able to make us wise into salvation. No one is saved apart from the truth of the gospel that we get from the written words of God. Now we may tell someone the gospel, we may share with someone the gospel, and we may not exactly quote a particular scripture, but if we know the gospel, and if we're sharing the gospel, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. If we're sharing the gospel, that he was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification, therefore we're justified by faith, and have access by grace. And so we quote Scripture, or we share the truth of the Scripture, and it's because of that truth of the written words of God that we can read and understand and come to believe ourselves, that we can turn around and share that Christ died for your sins, was buried and raised again for your justification. And so there's no sharing or no knowledge of the gospel or no knowledge of bringing someone to salvation apart from the Word of God. And then we continued on with the inspiration, and the word inspiration means inspire or to breathe in. And so we talked about how God himself, as the author, breathed in to the Bible writers those words that they would write. And we emphasized that God is the author, but the human instruments were the pen that he used. And just like if we pick up a different pen, a different ink pen with a different style, a different, you know, whatever, then our writing looks different maybe because of the type of pen that we use. And so the same thing, we have different ideas, different expressions and different styles of communication. In other words, the pen that God used had their own personality, but God breathed into those instruments, those pens, his very words, using them and their personality to put every word just like he wanted it. And that inspired word of God is profitable for all those things that we're told about. We also saw there in 2 Peter chapter 1 that no prophecy of the scriptures of any private interpretation. In other words, none of the forthtelling of the words of God was just written by this is what Paul thinks or this is what Moses thinks. It wasn't their own private interpretation. It wasn't their own private words, but it was their personality, but it was the very words of God. And these holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Again, that inspiration of God. Now we're going to add to this morning in 2 Peter. Turn over a couple of chapters, or turn over a couple of pages to chapter 3. And we're going to add to this Peter's comments about what Paul wrote. And Peter writes here in 2 Peter chapter 3, look at verses 15 and 16. An account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. And of course, I want to elaborate more than I have the time to, but Peter's explaining to his audience, and of course we know that Peter was writing to believing Israel, those of the little flock, those had believed on Jesus during the ministry of John the Baptist, in the ministry of Jesus himself, the ministry of the 12, concerning Jesus as the Son of God, concerning the tribulation, concerning the second coming, establishing the kingdom. Peter writes to the circumcised believers of the little flock, that church there in Jerusalem. As he writes to them, he's saying their account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. And so, you know, they've got questions. And if you read through Peter's writings here, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, they've got questions. Why has he delayed his coming? Because no one in the first century expected, no one in the times of the writing of the New Testament, no one anticipated the age of grace, the dispensation of grace, to last thousands of years. In the early Acts under Peter and the apostles, from Acts chapter 1 through Acts chapter 8 or in there, they were on the threshold of the tribulation and they were waiting for the rise of the Antichrist and the great persecutions. Of course, they were suffering persecutions. But they were waiting to go through all those things that were prophesied by the 70th week of Daniel and the time of Jacob's trouble, all those Old Testament prophecies about the tribulation. They were anticipating going through that and then Christ coming back and establishing that kingdom. And then when Paul is saved by the grace of God and God reveals to him that body of truth and the things concerning Israel and the prophecies regarding Israel are put on hold, even Paul did not anticipate the dispensation of grace, the ministry committed to him. Even Paul did not anticipate that thing lasting beyond his lifetime, because he writes in 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18 about the rapture of the church, and he says, "We which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds." Paul anticipated the rapture to happen in his own lifetime. And so then we find, of course, 2 Timothy, he comes to the realization that, you know, he's done his job and it's time for him to go. And so he's encouraging Timothy. No one in the first century expected it to be 2,000 years. And so as Peter writes, he's talking about this long length of time and the second coming hasn't happened. So he says there, verse 15, an account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood. I mean, even Peter's writing. There's some things that Paul wrote. Man, they make you scratch your head. They're hard to be understood. And he goes on and says, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Now again, a lot of things could be said about this passage. I'm not going to let myself veer off course any further, but I want you to understand that as Peter's writing by the inspiration of God, by the God-breathed words that he's given Peter, the Holy Spirit of God has given Peter as he writes these words, he tells us in verse 16 that Paul's epistles are scripture. Where he says, as also in all his epistles, and those that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures. So he refers to the other scriptures, and by implication, he's saying that Paul's epistles are scriptures, the written words of God, given by God to the instrument, through the instrument of Paul, our apostle. So I thought that was interesting to add to this. Now, one of the interesting things about that as we continue on and I start opening this thing up for us is that Paul was the most prolific Bible writer that there was as far as number of books. I won't say by number of words or number of chapters, but by number of books. Paul wrote 13 books of the 27 books in our New Testament. And so he wrote nearly half of those books. He's the most prolific Bible writer in all the Word of God. Moses wrote the five books of Moses. It's believed commonly that Moses probably also wrote the book of Job, so if we give him credit for that, Moses wrote six books. Solomon wrote three books. John wrote five books. Peter wrote three books. Jeremiah wrote two books. And then all the other known Bible writers, they just have one book attributed to them. And so that's interesting. We have 66 books in our Bible, 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New Testament. The Bible was written over a period of 1,500 years, and it was written by 35 known authors, because there's some books that we don't know who wrote them. There's speculation and names and ideas are thrown out there, but the book itself does not tell us. We don't have anywhere that gives us a record of who wrote certain books. But from the time that I believe the oldest book in the Bible is Job, from the time Job was written to the time that I believe that the last book in the Bible written, I believe, was 2 Timothy. And so from the time that Job was written to the time 2 Timothy was written, there was a period of 1,500 years. Again, if Moses wrote Job, and so you got Job, and we're going to put it in there with Moses' writings, and so if he wrote that during that period of time that Genesis through Deuteronomy, those five books of the law, were written, that was 3,400 years ago. Approximately, I'm giving approximately the numbers, and it was over a 40-year period that Moses wrote those books that he wrote. He began writing those back in 1400 B.C. And so from Job to Malachi, again I say Job because I believe Job is the oldest, might be better to understand, from Genesis to Malachi was covered a period of 900 years. And then we've got the 400 silent years. Malachi indeed was the last book written in our Old Testament. And so from Malachi to the time that Matthew was written, Matthew being first in our what we call the New Testament, but also first of those New Testament letters, those New Testament books. So from the time that Malachi was written to the time that Matthew was written is 400 plus years. We have what's called the 400 silent years, and then John the Baptist shows up on the scene, and it's about AD 37 that Matthew is written. And then from AD 37, that first New Testament book, Matthew, to the time Paul writes 2 Timothy, before the end of his life, so we could say maybe 2 Timothy's written around AD 67. It's commonly believed Paul was beheaded in 67, 68. And so we've got a period of 30 years then that the New Testament books were written over that course of time, from AD 37 to AD 67. Now, I mentioned a while ago that there's 35 known authors. And, you know, you go down and look and you can identify who those known authors were. But there's also several books that we do not know who wrote them. Joshua, Judges, and Ruth. We don't know who wrote those books. They're not attributed to anyone. I did as much research as I could, and I couldn't find anybody that gave a name or attributed those books to any in a particular person or people. What I got was that it's commonly held that just unnamed priestly historians, those of Aaron and Levi, priestly historians, wrote the books of Joshua, Judges, and Ruth. We don't know who wrote 1 and 2 Samuel. We don't know who wrote 1 and 2 Kings. We don't know who wrote the book of Esther. Again, it could be that those priestly historians wrote those books. While I mentioned the book of Esther, does anyone know the most unique thing about the book of Esther that's only true in the book of Esther? Anybody have an idea? God or the Lord, the name of God, or the Lord, Jehovah, none of those names that are attributed to God are found in the book of Esther. Now, as you read the book of Esther, do you see the hand of God at work? Oh, most definitely. But it's just interesting that the only book in our Bible that God's name, in any of God's name, there's no direct reference to God himself in the book of Esther. Again, I've already mentioned that we don't know who wrote Job, but as I've studied, it's commonly believed that Moses probably wrote Job. And then, of course, we have the book of Hebrews in our New Testament, the only book we don't know the author of beyond God himself in the New Testament is the book of Hebrews. I can say to you that I do not know who wrote Hebrews, but I do know that Paul did not write it. And I won't go into the study of that. We've done that study before and may do that study again, but I can assure you through the internal evidence of the book itself, go read Hebrews chapter 2, if no other place. But Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, if you have eyes to see and ears to hear and a heart to understand, you should be able to read through Hebrews 2, 1 through 5 and understand. That makes it very clear that there's no way that Paul was the author of Hebrews. Some have attributed the book of Hebrews to Barnabas. You know who Barnabas is. Went with Paul on his first missionary journey. Barnabas is the man who, when Paul came to Jerusalem after his 3 years in Arabia, after he was blinded on the road to Damascus and went in and came to know the Lord and went to Arabia there for the 3 years and returned to Damascus, and then he makes his way to Jerusalem, and he's 15 days in Jerusalem. It was Barnabas who introduced Paul, who was called Saul still at that time, to Peter and James, the Lord's brother there in Jerusalem, and Paul saw none of the other apostles during that time. And so we know who Barnabas is, and again, Barnabas went with Paul on his first missionary journey. Some attribute it to Barnabas. Some attribute it to Apollos. The book of Hebrews is very eloquent and very poetic. And Apollos was known to be a very polished speaker. He was very eloquent. And so, who knows? You have those questions when you get to glory. I'd really like to have an answer to this one. And I'm going to tell you right now, that's one going to be up high on my list of questions to ask. Who wrote Hebrews? I'm just real curious about that. But I stopped short of saying that I believe for a fact that Barnabas or Apollos or whoever else wrote it. But I'm very adamant that I know Paul did not write the book of Hebrews. All right. And again, these are just all interesting things as we consider the inspiration of the Scriptures. All right, let's look at some other things. Let's talk about the prophetical books. If you're going to talk about the inspiration of Scriptures, you've got to talk about Bible prophecy. And I don't know, I've not gone in there and named them or counted them myself. One writer that I was reading after there in this study said that there's some 1,817 prophecies throughout the Bible. Now, I have no idea whether that number's correct or not, but I will say that I think it would have no problem saying there's, you know, 1,000, 2,000 or more Bible prophecies. Now, many and most of those Bible prophecies have been fulfilled and were fulfilled exactly like God said that they would be fulfilled. And needless to say, this is one of those topics where if we wanted to, in our study of the inspiration of scriptures, we could go through and study Bible prophecies. Here's where it was prophesied and here's where it was fulfilled. How long do you think that might take us? It would take a long time to identify every prophecy and show where that prophecy was fulfilled, or then identify those prophecies that are yet to be fulfilled. So that's why I say I kind of limited the subject to not be all-inclusive, but we're just identifying that certainly that there are a great deal of prophecies, and when it comes to those prophecies, they have been fulfilled just like God would said they would be fulfilled in the way and the manner and the time that God said. And therefore, if the majority of those prophecies were fulfilled just like God said they would be, then we can be confident that those prophecies that are yet to be fulfilled will indeed be fulfilled. And again, a reference to the tribulation, the second coming, the millennial reign, the new heaven and new earth, all those things that are subjects of Bible prophecy. Out of the 66 book of our Bible, there are 18 books that are specifically prophetical books, which means that 27% of the books of our Bible are prophetic books. And that's the books, the 17 books of the Old Testament, Isaiah through Malachi. And sometimes in your study, you'll hear a reference to major prophets, minor prophets. That doesn't mean that one is any more or any less important. It just has to do with the length of the prophecy. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, these are major prophets because they're big books. And then when you have the Hoseas and the Joels and the Amoses and the Obadiahs and those smaller books, those are called the minor prophets. And it has nothing to do with one being more important than the other. It has to do with the size of the book more than the content or the authority of the writer. And so 20% of those books, Isaiah through Malachi, the 17 of the Old, and of course the prophetic book in the New Testament is the book of Revelation. And it's the only complete prophetical book in our New Testament. Now, so that's 27%. Now, that's not including prophecies that we find in the writings of Moses. Was not Moses a prophet? Did not Moses prophesy many things? And you can read through the writings of Moses. I think about the Song of Moses as you come to the end of Deuteronomy and chapter 32, 33 in there. And we've talked about those in the past. And so Moses had prophecies within his book. David and those who attributed to the Psalms, where there are not many what we call prophecies, messianic prophecies in the Psalms. And then you have Jesus. When he taught in his earthly ministry, did he not give prophecies? Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, those places especially where Jesus gave prophecies. And Paul himself gave, we talk about prophecy and mystery and we separate those two. But when Paul himself talked about the rapture of the church, when he talked, and even Paul talked about the second coming and establishing the kingdom, when Paul spoke of future events, then we could attribute certain prophecies regarding the body of Christ, and then even prophecies regarding Israel that were repeated or given by Paul. I think of 2 Timothy chapter 3 when it starts out, "This know also in the last days, perilous times shall come." Well, if Paul was talking about the last days of the church, the body of Christ in the first century, do you think that that could be considered a prophecy concerning the last days of the church, the body of Christ? And so I would come in there and add all that together. If 27% of the actual books are prophetical, the 17 in the Old and the 1 in the New, and then you toss in there those writings of Moses and David and Jesus and Paul, those things that they said, I'd say we can probably come up with well over a third of our Bible, or at least a third of our Bible, is prophetic in nature. And again, what does that have to do with the inspiration of Scripture? If the prophecies are given and fulfilled, as the bulk of them already have been, then we can have confidence in our Bible, this book we hold in our hand, and its inspiration, that those remaining prophecies will indeed be fulfilled.
Amen.
All right, so that's very good. Let's go with me in that subject, a couple of references, because I put a handle on it for you. Go back to Deuteronomy 18. Deuteronomy 18. This gives us a Bible verse for this. Deuteronomy 18. Look at 20, 21, and 22. Deuteronomy 18, 20, 21, and 22. God's given to Moses. Moses given to the children of Israel the test of the prophets. And in the previous verses, 15 through 19, looking at the headings in my old Schofield Bible, in 15 through 19, it gives the heading there is the great prophecy of Messiah, the prophet. And then you come to verse 20 through 22, the test of the prophets. But the prophets which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. And if thou say in thine heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord hath not spoken? Verse 22, when a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not, nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken. But the prophet hath spoken it presumptuously, and thou shalt not be afraid of him. And so if a prophet comes on with something that doesn't come to pass, he's not a prophet of the Lord. But on the other hand, if that prophet gives you something and it does indeed come to pass, as our Bible prophets have done, then we know that that prophet is of the Lord. Go with me to Isaiah 46. Isaiah 46. And this is just kind of a little side verse that helps us with this. Verse 9 and 10. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasures. And so God has declared the end from the beginning and from ancient times, and he makes mention of those things that are not yet done. And he says, but my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasures. So we have the promise from God, again, that those prophecies that have yet to be fulfilled will indeed be fulfilled. Now, I told you we weren't going to go into deep a lot of prophecies, but there's one particular thing that I want to show you, and it's concerning a guy named Cyrus. And so go with me to Isaiah chapter 44. Isaiah chapter 44. It's just a little interesting tidbit that'll be helpful to you. And the reason I'm doing this is to show a very specific thing in Bible prophecy. And so we're at Isaiah chapter 44. We're going to read Isaiah 44, 28 and Isaiah 45, verse 1. Isaiah 44, 28 and 45, 1. Thus saith, that saith of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and shall perform all my pleasure, even saying to Jerusalem, thou shalt be built, and to the temple thy foundation shall be laid. Thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden to subdue nations before him, and I will loose the loins of kings to open before him the two leaves gated, and the gates shall not be shut. And at the top of my Bible, I've got BC 712, if that's a correct date. That they're mentioning this man named Cyrus. Go with me back to Jeremiah 29. Jeremiah 29, turn to your right, Jeremiah 29. It doesn't mention Cyrus's name, but because of another passage we're going to, we need to look at this. Jeremiah 29, the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 10. For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you in causing you to return to this place. Again, the context of where we are with Isaiah and Jeremiah, they're prophesying about Israel and Judah going into captivity. And they're going to be, the temple's going to be destroyed. Solomon's temple is destroyed. But the prophecies here, Jeremiah 29:10, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, after Judah is held in captive in Babylon for 70 years after that destruction of Solomon's temple, he says, I will visit you, God will visit Israel, and perform his good word toward them in causing you to return to this place. Now, I see verse 11 here, so I've got to throw this in here as a side note. It's free, it's not part of the message, but it's just throw it in there. Verse 11. As we read verse 11, you may not have ever read verse 10, but you've heard verse 11 quoted many times. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. This is one of those passages that people reach out there and grab and claim for themselves. But who was Jeremiah? Who was God writing to through the pen of Jeremiah? He's talking to Israel. I'd be real careful about going there and claiming these passages because they sound real good. That's that devotional application of Scripture that can lead you astray. But I would venture to say that you could walk into any Christian, quote unquote, Christian bookstore and find a real pretty plaque that has this verse on it. And you see that shared oftentimes. You'll hear preachers preaching and they'll share that verse completely out of context, completely out of application. But verse 10 is the important thing for us to notice. All right, go with me to 2 Chronicles, chapter 36. All the way back to your left. 2 Chronicles, chapter 36. Second Chronicles chapter 36, the end of the Chronicles. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, verse 22 and 23. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord spoken by the mouth of Jeremiah might be accomplished. Well, where was that spoken? Jeremiah 29:10. That the word of the Lord spoken by the mouth of Jeremiah might be accomplished, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put it also in writing, saying, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth hath the Lord God of heaven given me, and he hath charged me to build him an house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah, who is there among you of all his people. The Lord his God be with him, and let him go up. Now look right there across the page at the book of Ezra. Look at chapter 1 of Ezra. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put it also in writing, saying, Thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he hath charged me to build him an house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is there among you of all his people? His God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel. He is the God which is in Jerusalem. And whosoever remaineth in any place where he sojourneth, let the men of his place help him with silver and with gold and with goods and with beasts, beside the freewill offerings, for the house of God is in Jerusalem. All right, now, Isaiah 44, where was that on the date?
712
B.C. If you're in the book of Ezra, as Ezra begins to write this, the date here in mind is 536. When Isaiah wrote Isaiah 44 and gave the Isaiah 44 and 45, 44:28, Isaiah 45:1, Cyrus was not even a gleam in his daddy's eye. You understand what I'm saying? 712 B.C., the man's name is given who's going to be ruling, who after the 7 years of captivity, after the destruction of Solomon's temple, the 70 years are to be accomplished, and then there's going to be a man, Cyrus, who's going to rise up, and he's the instrument God's going to use to bring the children of Israel back into Jerusalem and allow them to rebuild that second temple, which was the temple that, of course, was involved in the New Testament with the like ministry of Jesus and the apostles and so on and so forth. So from 712 to 536, how many years is that? Somebody do the math. What's that? 536.
180.
Yeah, 180 something years. So Cyrus is given a name 180 years before he's ever in the position to do what he did to fulfill. Do you think God gave Isaiah the name Cyrus? Do you think Cyrus's mama named him Cyrus because she says he's going to be the guy that God's going to? In other words, God did that. That's just an interesting thing.
Yeah.
A little detail, like the name of a man who's going to rise to power. 180-something years, his name is given. 180-something years later, that man, Cyrus, is the man who comes in there. I think God did that. You think that's good evidence of the inspiration of the Scriptures? Now, I'm going to throw a little private interpretation of my own in here. Go with me back to Revelation.
176
years. Okay, very good.
The hard part to remember is you're saying that. I'm thinking 536 and 712 would be after.
Yeah, you got to realize.
Backwards.
Yeah, you got to realize BC, they're counting backwards. Yeah, so 712 was longer ago than 536.
Yeah.
That's right. All right. Go with me to Revelation chapter 2. And this is one of those things, this is what I think. If you agree with me, praise the Lord. If you don't agree with me, praise the Lord. That's why I said this is my own personal observation. If God could give Isaiah the name of Cyrus, 180 years, whatever, ahead of time, when I go to the book of Revelation, I believe Revelation is a prophecy, and I believe it's a prophecy concerning end times regarding the children of Israel. I don't see the church, the body of Christ, in any way, shape, or form in the book of Revelation. I don't believe the seven letters written by John in Revelation in chapters 2 and 3. I don't believe those letters to those churches have anything to do with any of our churches. I don't think, like the classic dispensationalists teach, that these churches show seven different church ages from the first century church to the church at the rapture. I don't think that. I think these are seven churches that will be in operate. Now, may they have been in operation back in the first century? Maybe. But if this is a book of prophecy, which John says it is, and it's things which are to come, which John says they are, then I believe that these are seven churches that will exist, not body of Christ churches, but Jewish churches, okay? Those who are responding in faith to that preaching of the two witnesses and the 144,000 during the tribulation. And so as they're writing these letters to these seven churches in Revelation chapter 2, verse 13, as he writes to the church at Pergamos, notice verse 13. He says, I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my faith. Even those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. Well, it gives the name Antipas. This name Antipas is not found anywhere else in Scripture. History does not give us this name of this man, Antipas. I studied and dug, you know, was there a man named Antipas in the first century that can be identified anywhere? And there's not. Well, for me, I believe that this is a prophecy given to John back there in the first century concerning what's going to be taking place during that seven-year tribulation. And just like Isaiah was given the name Cyrus, I believe that John was given the name Antipas. And I think out there in the future, after the church is caught up and God resumes his prophetic dealings with Israel, during that period of time, I think that this guy Antipas will be a faithful martyr, and that his name will be there, that he will be one of those who are slain because he's enduring to the end, right, of his life. And he's slain and made a martyr. And I think that Scripture, that's going to give just that abundant confidence in the inspiration of Scripture to those who are living during that time after we're caught up. Here's this guy's name. That's what I believe. Now again, that's just where I'm at. You can take it or leave it. If you like it, praise the Lord. If you don't like it, don't worry about it. And it ain't something to fight about. But I do believe that. And it's interesting. It's interesting to say the least. But I do believe that it's a prophecy, that it's all prophecy concerning the tribulation and the coming kingdom. And I think that man's name, Antipas, is put in there for a specific reason. And that there will be an Antipas during the tribulation who will be martyred during that time. All right, now, enough of that. Now, as we said, there's no way we can go into all the prophecies concerning Jesus himself. We've studied those, we've heard those. That, again, would be, you know, we talked about all the prophecies of Scripture, but even if we just narrow it down to those, what we call messianic prophecies. But we do know that Jesus was prophesied that he would be of Judah, that he would be of the lineage of David, that he would be born in Bethlehem, that he would come out of Egypt, that he would be raised in Nazareth. You know, all those things that we know that were prophesied about Jesus that came true and came fulfilled. All right. Now, let me throw out a couple more things before we finish up. Isaiah. How many books? You don't have to turn there. I'm just giving information. How many chapters are in the book of Isaiah?
66.
66 chapters. 66 chapters in the book of Isaiah. 66 books in our Bible. I don't think that's coincidental. The first book of our New Testament, there's 39 books in the Old Testament, and then 27 in the New Testament. And so that means that the 40th chapter, so if we have things that coincide, it's interesting that Matthew is the 40th book of our Bible. Who are we introduced to in the book of Matthew? Jesus, but John the Baptist. Okay? So it's interesting about the voice of one crying in the wilderness that goes forth to prepare the way of the Lord. If you go back and read Isaiah chapter 40, guess what Isaiah chapter 40 starts out about? talking about a prophecy concerning John the Baptist. It's the 40th chapter of Isaiah, and it's the 40th book of our Bible. Again, I don't think that's a coincidence. I think that's inspiration. The last book of our Bible is Revelation. And if you go read, as far as the way it's in our canon of Scripture, if you go read Isaiah 66, so you go to Isaiah 40, you see a great things that go with Matthew. If you go to Isaiah 66, you'll find great many things that coincide with the book of Revelation, because Isaiah 66 talks about the king and the kingdom and the new heaven and the new earth and the Gentiles coming to Israel and all those things that are in the book of Revelation. Interesting stuff. I will have you turn here. We're almost through. Psalm 117. The 117th Psalm. Again, just interesting stuff. The shortest chapter in our Bible is Psalm 117. These are right in the middle of our entire Bible, Genesis to Revelation. The shortest chapter of the Bible is Psalm 117. Notice the content. Oh, praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise Him, all ye people. That includes the Gentiles and the Jews. All ye nations, all ye people. For His merciful kindness is great toward us. And the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise ye, Lord. So everybody's to praise the Lord according to the shortest chapter of the Bible. The middle chapter of our Bible is Psalm 118, and you've probably heard this before. The middle verse of our Bible is verse 8. Psalm 118, verse 8. The middle verse from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22, whatever that last verse is. This is the middle verse of our Bible, Psalm 118:8. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. I think that's interesting. I think that's a sign of inspiration. Psalm 117, the shortest one, falls right there. Praise the Lord, everybody. Psalm 118, better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Boy, that's a scriptural truth from Genesis to Revelation. Guess what the two middle words of Psalm 118:8 is?
The Lord.
The Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. The Lord is, and notice the capital L-O-R-D. The Lord is the center of this book. And guess what the longest chapter in our Bible is? Huh? Psalm 119. Now, is that coincidental? Psalm 117, the shortest. Psalm 118, the middle verse. And now Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in our Bible with 176 verses. And you know what the overall message of Psalm 119 is? What's the theme? What's the main thing of Psalm 119?
Praise of Scripture.
What's that?
Praise of Scripture.
It's the praise of the written words of God. You read through Psalm 119, and it's the statutes and the precepts and the laws and the commandments and the, the words. Psalm 119 is the place that talks about the Word of God. Praise the Lord. It's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. The Lord is the center of it all. How do we find out about all this? Psalm 119, through the written words of God. Do you think that's coincidental? I don't. Longest chapter in the Bible, again, is Psalm 119. The longest verse in our Bible, and I'll finish up with this, is Esther 8, verse 9. It has 90 verses. The shortest verse in our Bible is John 11:35, and it has two words, and who knows what that is?
Jesus wept.
I don't think that's insignificant either. Jesus wept. And that, of course, is upon the account of Lazarus. Did Jesus know that he was going to raise Lazarus from the dead? So why is he crying? He's feeling the hurt and the heartache that those people hurt and heartache. A lot of reasons could be given. Jesus wept. Well, all those are interesting things. I hope that you found them interesting. I hope that when you pick up your Bible, that you realize it's not like any other book. It's the God-breathed words given from the heart of God to man. Paul wrote, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." How do we get God's mind in us? The written Word of God. This inspired book. Well, I'm going to finish up with that as far as inspiration goes. Again, we can carry on and on for a long period of time talking about inspiration, but we're going to let this be sufficient. I hope that everyone sitting in here believes that the book in their hand is the Word of God. And that God gave His Word and He inspired His Word. And as we continue our study, we'll pick up and we'll talk about the preservation of Scripture. And eventually we'll get into the interpretation of Scripture as we talk about the Word of God. Because everything that we're going to believe, do, act upon, function as members of the body of Christ, they've got to be anchored in this written Word of God. So we have to start with that firm foundation. I have a Bible, and it's exactly what God wanted me to have. That's real important. All right, let's take our break.